So today I'm going to talk a bit about what the course is about, who is the intended audience, and answering your questions if you have any questions about it. So we already quickly saw something about me, and I am going to deliver the training at NoCon together with one of my colleagues. This colleague is called Rafa. He joined actually in 2000. He is one of our most experienced trainers here at Rischke. He will join me for delivering this course. And basically, the target audience of this course are developers, experienced developers that know more about how to write high quality and secure code. And you may ask, like, is that needed? Why is that needed? Well, if you look at the statistics, things are, even with all the effort that is being put in modern systems, creating them, making them, even also hardening them, actually, when we look at the statistic of the amounts of vulnerabilities, it is easily to get quite depressed. People are doing a lot of hard work, except we still see more and more issues out there. And while I don't think that it is because people are doing a worse job, I think it is simply because what we see is that the complexity and size of systems is exploding. And that also makes it harder and harder to just fix any issues you have, like when the system is already there. And it also means that we need to become better at making systems secure from the start. And of course, there are many reasons why it is why you would like to want to invest in the security of your system. There are reasons like I want to be certified. However, there are also more reasons like to use it to distinguish yourself from the competition or to prevent brand damage. However, from the perspective of software vulnerabilities, there's actually a very interesting additional motivator. So something colleagues have worked on is to try to create a tool to help you to quantify the cost of vulnerabilities. So there is actually quite some research out there that that gives indication how expensive it is to actually fix a vulnerability, and this depends on where this vulnerability is found, where it is found in the life cycle of a product. It will probably not be hard to imagine that if you deliver a product and then you are finding a vulnerability, it is going to be way more expensive to fix this vulnerability than if you find it during the implementation or testing phase of your product. However, ideally, you are already designing your system in such a way that you are not going to introduce vulnerabilities. And this cost calculator, what it tries to do is it tries to put in perspective how the maturity of a product, how this reflects in the cost of fixing vulnerability. And this brings me actually to the economics of security. So perfect security is simply, it doesn't exist. So it is all about having a good enough security. And in theory, it is possible to have unbreakable products. In reality, this is not really feasible. However, what is definitely feasible is to bring your security up to a level that it's not attractive anymore for an attacker to attack your product. And the idea behind this is that the investment to develop an attack is bigger than what an attacker can gain out of it. And what you can actually make this make calculations about this, and what you see is that if you increase the time, the expertise, the time of tooling that is required, the knowledge of a product, the number of devices, etc., this actually increases the cost and the investment that needs to be done. However, there is also something you can get out of a product. It could be that you can gain take over a device, or maybe there are interesting assets inside the device, like cryptographic keys. And the whole idea is that if you make the investment bigger than what you can gain out of it, you are certainly not such an attractive target anymore. However, it's difficult. I will be fair, security is just difficult. And one of the reasons for that is that as a developer, you need to protect and identify every possible part of your system. And usually this surface can be very big. And an attacker only needs to find one hole in it. And as a developer, you need to make the whole system robust enough so an attacker cannot find a hole in that. And actually, usually, as a developer, you are not the only party that is involved in it. You might rely on third-party libraries or maybe suppliers, vendors. And if you combine this with the complexity of modern products together with very tight deadlines, you have really a mixture that is problematic and or difficult to get your security right. However, there is a way that really can help a lot, and that is having good secure development practices from the start. And in this way, you prevent that you later on really have to go through that cycle of fixing all the potential issues as much as possible. And these are the reasons why we started developing this course. And during this course, what we try to aim for is that we are not just giving the characteristics of vulnerabilities or some theoretical knowledge, but we really try to change the mindset of somebody. So what we try to achieve is that by going through vulnerabilities and actually going through exercises where you have to find the vulnerabilities yourself, is that while you are developing, you start to have like a third sense that is actually triggering the moments you see insecure development practices. And the way we are doing that is that we start with discussing, for example, what techniques are available to find vulnerabilities, what can be used by developers, what can be used by attackers. And this way, we try to broaden your tool set for making your systems more secure. And then we go deeper and we go into topics like code standards, secure coding guidelines. And we all do this to create a base for discussing the most common and most severe vulnerabilities. And actually, another thing is we will not only focus on vulnerabilities. We actually also focus on how can we actually make systems more robust in the presence of vulnerabilities. I think it's nowadays widely accepted that getting rid of all vulnerabilities is simply not going to happen anytime soon, at least not with systems that are fully written in C or other low-level languages which have inherent limitations. So maybe good to mention something is that this course is really focused on embedded system development, where C and also C++ are still very widely used. And this is also why this is the main language we will use during our course. So during day one, what we do is first the discovery techniques, and then we discuss the review methodology, and then we start to dive into vulnerabilities. So buffer overflows and buffer overreads are still one of the most common vulnerabilities. And this is actually also one of the topics we will discuss most in depth. And actually, it's also the one we will start with. So what we will do is we really go into the details here, not so much about how an attacker is going to use a vulnerability like that. It's really about the knowledge you need to have to understand, like, why is this a problem? How can I prevent it? How can I make my system more robust? And then we will actually move on to C as a programming language. And actually, we will see that there are certain inherent limitations to the language, and also that how these limitations and how C as a language developed actually can lead to vulnerabilities. And the first day, we will close with discussing the common exploitation mitigations. These are basically the three mitigations that are now around for like 20 years, widely deployed, and they really have raised the bar and forced attackers to change the methodology. We call them the common mitigation techniques because they are widely deployed. However, there are still embedded systems out there that are not using them, which is really a shame if you think about it. And then in the second day, we actually go through a whole list of different topics. We go through issues like what can go wrong with if you use your the file system of your device to store information. How can an attacker leverage that? But also like if you use dynamic memory, what can go wrong if you do this incorrectly? What can go wrong if you use cryptography? Type confusion vulnerability, race conditions, shell injection, even SQL injection is a topic we are going to discuss. And maybe what's very interesting is that at the end of the second day is that we finish with what are really the state-of-the-art exploit mitigations that really bring the complexity of performing attacks to a new level. So in that topic, we are going to discuss topics like control flow integrity, shadow stacks, and actually what you see now is that very slowly they start to penetrate the market. So to give you a bit of a better idea of how our course looks like, I would like to show you a random snippets of our training material, and this way I hope you can get a better idea of the style of our course, but also the level and if it's interesting for you. So one of the first things we do when we start with the course is that we try to get a common language for the lingo that is being used. So what is a vulnerability? What is a threat? What are risks? What is an asset? And this way we try to be able to, so if we discuss things like that, we all know what we are talking about. And then we move on to things like methodology, how to do a code review, and we really drill down to the steps that needs to be done, in which order, and how you can maximize the effectiveness of code reviews if you want to do them, and also how you can integrate them in your existing processes, but also what you need to do to focus on the right things, and also what needs to be done that even while you have results, they are not wasted. So it's a very important step that you not just identify if you are developing vulnerabilities, but also that they get remediated. And then towards going into the details of actual vulnerabilities, what we do is that we also will discuss certain technicalities, like for example, how does a stack look like? How are functions chained together, and what's actually being done for that in the memory of the system? And this is quite essential knowledge if you want to understand why, for example, a stack buffer overflow is so dangerous, and why an attacker is very interested in finding a vulnerability like that, especially when you do not have exploit mitigations inside your system. So when we have discussed things like this, which is sort of required to, or which is required to really understand what you need to protect in your system, we start to discuss actual vulnerabilities. And what we use for that is just real open source project that had actual vulnerabilities out there. And I will give you an example of that. So in this case, this is an exercise of where we discuss the effect of integer underflows and overflows, and for example, how this can result in buffer overflows. And what we actually are going to do is that you get a part of that code where this vulnerability is, and like here, you get some hints, you get the request to look at a very specific function, and then you get the task to actually look for that vulnerability. Of course, we do this under guidance, so we slowly guide you in the right direction. But in this way, this is a way of training the third sense to get the feeling like what are the code patterns and what are potential issues and what should I be looking for. And what we then do is we discuss together, like, what did we find? How is data flowing through a function? Why is this a potential issue? How can you fix it? How can you prevent it, etc.? And we do this based on actual vulnerabilities. One example is the Linux kernel, but we have several other open source projects we use for inspiration. And then on the second day, where we go into like things like dynamic memory, we discuss, for example, things like double free vulnerabilities and many others. And we also discuss why is it actually a problem? Because, of course, you can fix the vulnerability. However, in some cases, you can also fix the reasons why vulnerabilities are vulnerabilities. And in that case, this is also why we take a high-level look at things like how, for example, heaps are being managed internally, how is the metadata looks like inside the system. And also, what we discuss here is what is possible on current systems, and how can those systems still be attacked? Another example of what we are going to discuss is cryptographic primitives and how they can be used, but also how they can be used incorrectly. And what we are going to discuss here is not so much about how you design secure crypto, but we are going to discuss some of the most common pitfalls here. And one of those examples is, for example, message authentication, where you do the comparison between the calculated and expected MAC value is not done in a secure way, and you can actually, for example, perform a timing attack on that. And in this way, you can actually bypass the authentication that is provided by this mechanism, which of course is not something you want. But we are not going to stop there. Many of the topics we discuss are agnostic to the system. So a buffer overflow, it can occur in an application, it can occur in a library, it can occur in an operating system, it can occur in a bootloader. However, we are also going to touch a little bit up on subsystem-specific vulnerabilities. And one of them, a very typical vulnerability that you see in operating system kernels, is that next to all those general vulnerability classes is that they have special characteristics. And one of them is, for example, is that if an address is provided by the application, actually there needs to be proper verification being done to see if the address that is being provided is, for example, not porting inside the kernel. And we're also going to take a look at that and see the complications that brings to have like proper pointer verification, but also kernels more robust, and also what is typical to see there. And also something that we are going to do is that while discussing all those vulnerability classes, we take a look at real-life vulnerabilities. So some of them really got big attention. One of them is the shell shock vulnerability. Another example is the dirty cow vulnerability that was part of the Linux kernel. And we are actually going to discuss in depth what is the problem, how is it possible that this problem was introduced, and to some degree even like how is it possible to prevent issues like that, which of course is with those high-profile, complex vulnerabilities that were not found for many years. This is, of course, difficult. But I think it is interesting to discuss how it is possible that modern systems have issues like this. As I said, at the end of day one, we are going to discuss the common mitigation techniques. We consider stack cookies, ASLR, and NX or DAP part of these mitigation techniques because they are widely used nowadays and because they are widely deployed. That does not mean that they are there in all systems yet, which is really a shame. However, on the last day, we are really going to focus on the state of the art here. For example, some of the things we are going to discuss have been introduced in the latest Android versions in the kernel that are really making the system more robust. We are, for example, also discussing pointer authentication, which was introduced in ARM 3.8.3 and is, for example, now implemented in the latest iPhone. And we are going to discuss how this can make systems more robust. And to, if you want to know more about our course, what we have done is that a part of the material that is also being used in this course is we have created an online version for it. And a demo of this online course is actually freely available on our website. And this way, you can also get a little bit more of an idea of what is the style, what are the type of exercises we have in there. We really begin with very simple exercises where the vulnerability is can be found in only a couple of lines of code, the problem, and only then we really go to dive into more complex code to finally end up with highly complex code like that you find in operating system kernels, etc. This is roughly my introduction of our course.